This is the San Francisco Recovery Theater's production of Reflections in Black. I'm Gloria Weinstock, your director, and I'm just so happy to see all of these wonderful, wonderful faces
and
bodies. I want to insist that you turn off your phones, timers, beepers, anything else that goes ding in the night. Take out candies, unwrap it now. So this is out of consideration for your fellow audience members and the actors. There's no late seating tonight. So if you're expecting someone to come in, I'm sorry. They're not getting in. Enjoy the show.
Good evening, my name is Mr. Geoffrey. I will be your host and tour guide for the evening. I want to thank each and every one of you for being here. And once again, make sure we're going to try to minimize audience excessive movement because we do have film going on. But I want to give you a little overview about recovery theater and what we're about. You know, recovery is really nothing more than discovery. A lot of times it gets a bad rap. The name is, you say in recovery, and people start trembling and get very, very fearful. But all we're trying to do is move to the next level. That is all. Recovery theater is determined and has a mission statement to take it to the people. We visit the hotels. We go to the SRO. We tell a story that is for us and about us. And we make sure that we present a reflection of what we view as reality. So I hope you enjoy what we're doing. I hope you enjoy our work. If you do, feel free to contact me immediately after the show because we always have a place for you. Okay.
I just discovered I'm drunk.
Another thing, ladies and gentlemen, you know, because we do deal with people as they are. Every now and then we get an individual that's in the beginning stages of his search. So I just ask you to have patience.
I just ask
you to have patience, and we'll deal with these individuals.
I don't got to.
Listen, man, what is it you want to say?
Can I just say so?
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, can we just hold the wall for a second? We'll deal with this. Look, brother, we got some expensive equipment now. Y'all ready?
Might have you believe this is a direct holdover from the African tradition of marketplace activity that parented the largest and most well-organized systems of trade in the world. One that survived the mass lobotomy attempt in hopes we would forget. It goes back to when life first began. All life began at the watering hole, and this is where evolution is taking us. Churches, fast food, cardiac arrest, pit stops. And an endless supply of liquor stores. The Africans used to say, before the white man came, we had the land and they had the Bible. Now we have the Bible and they have the land. Buffalo soldiers. Buffalo soldiers. Tell me when will they call you, a
South and many other areas for the jobs in the shipyards to try to make an entrance into mainstream society. Because we thought we were going to step up, moving on up. But of course, there was one issue that seemed to follow us wherever we went, and that's Jim Crow.
Too bad, boy. It's not your fault entirely. Has to be this way. First war didn't change much for us, boy. But this one gonna change a lot of things. And Nazis ain't all crazy. Whole lot of people can't fit into where things seem to be going. Like you, CJ. Black race can't afford you no more. Used to be a time we see people like you singing, clowning, Yasser Boston, we wouldn't do anything. Folks like that. You was a good homie kind of nigga. Folks needed somebody to mistreat, call a name, they paraded you. Remind them of old days. Cornbread baking, greens in a hand cooking, daddy out chopping cotton, grandmammy sitting in the front porch smoking a pipe, or not no more. David Geechee is gone, boy. Only thing moves the race now is power. It's all white respect. And people like you make us seem like fools. And we can't let nobody go on thinking we all like you. You bring us down. Make people think the whole race is unfit. And I waited a long time for you, boy. But I got you. I try to get rid of you wherever I go. Put two Geechees in jail in Fort Campbell, Kentucky. Three in Fort Huachuca. And now I got you. One less fool for the race to be ashamed of. Now we'll get that old boy Carl next.
Paul Leroy Robeson.
He was our prince. He was as famous as a prince, and he was as fabulous. I mean, who would ever imagine that we would have an actor activist? He supported the troops back in World War II. But when he supported civil rights, his passport was taken away from him. His history was erased. They didn't want to have anything to do with him. He was damn near deported. But he sang a song that exemplified who we were and where we've been through.
Old Man River, that old man river, he must know something, but don't say nothing. He keeps on rolling, he just keeps rolling along. He don't plant taters, he don't plant cotton. And them that plant some are so forgotten. Yet old man river, he just keeps rolling along. You and me, we sweat and strain, bodies all aching and racked with pain. Tote that barge, lift that bale, you get a little drunk and you land in jail. Well, I gets weary and sick of trying. I'm tired of living, yet scared of dying. Yet old man river, he just keeps rolling
existed and lasted from 1954 to 1968. In 1968, two black psychiatrists penned a novel. It became something that was required in school. It validated our thoughts, black rage. At the same time, the civil rights movement was giving birth to the black power movement, who had a sister, the black arts movement. Both of these worked together. And they all dealt the same question. A nigger's face.
People kill me talking about niggers are lazy. Niggers is the most hardworking people in the world. Worked 300 years for free and didn't take no lunch break. Now all of a sudden niggers are lazy, don't know how to work. All of a sudden when you got to pay niggers, ain't no work for them to do. If it wasn't for you, the white man would be poor. Every little bit he got standard on top of you. That's how he could reach so high. He'd give you $3 a day for 6 months. He got him a railroad for 100 years. All you got is 6 months worth of $3 a day. And now you can't get that. There ain't no money in niggas working. Look out there on the street. If there was some money in it, if the white man could figure out a way to make some money putting niggas to work, we'd all be working. He ain't building no more railroads, he got that. He ain't building no more highways. Somebody had already stuck the telephone poles in the ground. That's been done already. The white man ain't stacking no more niggas. Now y'all know what I'm talking about, stacking niggas, right? Well, here's how that goes. Say you ain't got nothing, right? So you go over here and get your nigger. Then you got something, see? You got one nigger. Now let that nigger plant something, get something out the ground. Even if it ain't nothing but a bushel of potatoes, you got one nigger and one bushel of potatoes. You take that bushel of potatoes, you go over here and get you another nigger. Now you got two niggers. You put them to work, you got two niggers and two bushels of potatoes. You take them bushel of potatoes, you go over here and you get you two more niggers. And that's how you stack a nigger on top of a nigger. And the white folks, they got to stack. I mean, they stack some niggers. Stacked up near 50 million niggers. You put them one after the other, they make 6 or 7 circles around the moon. Lucky the boat didn't sink with all the niggers they had stacked up here. Took them 2 extra months to get here because the boat rides so low in the water. Couldn't find enough work for you back then. And now they got to pay you, they can't find you none. This was a different time. Wouldn't be nobody in the street. We'd all be in the cotton fields.
Black Art School. Black Art School. That's what this is all about. It was started by Amiri Baraka back in Harlem. Time magazine penned it as probably, singly, the most crucial piece of African-American literature today. And it went so far as to say, probably American literature, period. Flat, bar none. But Amir didn't do it all by himself. There was Ed Bullins, Marvin X, Sonia Sanchez, and a whole host of others. But we really need to understand what the mindset was of the communication through the arts. So I want you to take a look at a piece of that history.
Damn! Yeah! Where's the motherfucking light switch? Can't find nothing this way.
Leaving these lights on. Thank God this day is over. Lord, what a trying, troublesome day. I'm trying to console my people about Brother Jackson's death at the hands of that white police. I tried to keep him from the path of violence, Lord. I tried to tell him where it was really Brother Jackson's fault for provoking that officer. There's a time for protest. There's a time for silence. They say the officer hit him a couple of times. Brother Jackson could have taken a beating. Wouldn't be the first time that Brother Jackson had taken a beating. Now the people want to go downtown and raise hell. Lord, they speak of vengeance. And we should leave such things in your hands. You said it. Vengeance is mine. Lord, for the first time in all my years of delivering God's word, they were unbelieving, beyond my control. What have I done wrong that is shaking their faith, Lord? I try to show them the right way, your way, but I'm truly perplexed. The mayor says if I can't stop him, there's going to be more trouble and more killing. Tell me what to do, Lord. Tell me how to save my people.
Oh, man, shut up and get up off the hook.
Who said that?
What do you mean, who? Who were you talking to? Didn't you expect to get an answer? That's right. Get up off your knees and stop trying to bullshit me. You ain't worried about what's going to happen to your people. You worried about what's going to happen to you if something happens to your people. You were so sure that if they go up against the white man, they're going to lose and Whitey won't need you no more. Or if they go up against Whitey and win, then they won't need you. Either way, your game is messed up. So you want things to stay just as they are. You tell them to do nothing but wait. Wait and turn the other cheek. No matter what Whitey do, always turn the other cheek. As long as you keep them off the white folks, you all right with the white folks. My people got to keep catching hell so you can live like this. You stop preaching and teaching my people that shit. If you don't stop, I'll rebuild myself and put something on your cheek.
Lord! Believe me, those were not my motives. I was only trying to bring them along in your righteous way. Didn't you say...
Don't tell me what I said, Janet! How in the hell you know I haven't changed my mind since then? How do you know how I feel about that violence, vengeance bullshit now? I haven't written anything since the Bible.
Well, I just thought that, I mean...
What do you mean, Janet?
Well, Lord, I'm just trying to... my people can't win with violence.
If you call what they doing now winning, then you the dumbest mother MF ever tried to interpret my word. My people can do anything if I'm with them. I can do anything but fail. Do you remember that line?
But there are men like the man who killed Brother Jackson who are hoping such a thing will happen. They want to come into the black community and kill a lot of innocent people.
So what? You got to bring some ass to get some ass.
chosen people?
You goddamn right! And you and everybody else better act like it!
I can't accept that.
What? You questioning me, man? God, to come out from here and whoop your...
No! No, Lord! I just thought that, you know...
Stop thinking! Especially for so many others. What you need to be thinking about is how to tell my people the opposite of what you've been telling them for so long. I know what's best. I made all this shit up. Y'all messed up. I'm trying to help straighten it out.
Well, give me the strength, Lord, and I will try.
Try? Man, you better.
Well, give me the strength, Lord, and I will try.
Try? Man, you better. Some of my people are going to have to die so the rest can live in peace.
But
nothing. Tomorrow you'll need a protest march to end all protest marches. Now, I'm not talking about no damn sing-along. I said a protest march. You'll demand justice. And if you don't get justice, you'll raise hell. I want Brother Jackson's death avenged. You tell my people to be ready. Ready for whatever. You tell them I don't want no more damn cheek turning. And if you don't tell them, you'll be the first one to feel my wrath. Now pray that you don't forget to do anything I've told you to do.
You know, this is a heavy burden you place on my shoulders, Lord.
I feel like I'm taking some of your burdens away.
Why? Why me?
Because I feel like it should be you. You don't question that white man's judgment. Don't you dare question mine.
No, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
And stop calling me Jesus. My name is God!
And so I was with Moses, and so I shall be with thee. I will not forsake thee or fail thee. An eye for an eye. A tooth for a tooth. Hand for hand. Foot for foot. Sisters, I had a talk with God last night. He told me to tell you that the time has come to put an end to this murder, suffering, oppression, and exploitation to which the white man subjects us. The time has come to put an end to the fear for which so long has suppressed our actions. The time has come!
As you can see, the Black Arts Movement provided a bridge between art and politics. It allowed us to talk freely about issues and things that affected us. 50 years after Lyndon Baines Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act of 1964, we were still dealing with an issue called black male imprisonment. Black males and blacks in general were going to prison at a higher rate than whites. Still are, and it continues to go on. It's an issue that we just can't seem to rectify. We need somebody who can speak for us. We need a mouthpiece. Let's listen to our lawyer. I mean, we paid enough for him.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, we have all heard information regarding black male incarceration. The prison system has grown disproportionately when comparing African Americans to the national population. Black teenage girls, now the fastest growing juvenile prison population. My client is being accused of double first degree murder. How can this be? My client is a 19-year-old African-American male trapped in an existence that is the equivalent of third world survival. And its rules that you or I know nothing about or have to care about. This young man has just begun his life and is doing the best he can to provide for himself and his family according to messages received via the media. The Herculean effort to assimilate into 21st century mainstream society, armed with the equivalent of Stone Age tools, is a recipe for failure. This young man sees independent entrepreneurship as his only means of escape. In other words, by any means necessary. Isn't it true that most of our greatest civic leaders started out selling illegal items, liquor, guns, etc.? This young man's dreams of success were smothered by the news that he would soon be the father of twin girls. So he threw himself into panic mode and stepped up his crack dealing, abandoning his hopes and dreams of playing for a Big Ten college on a basketball scholarship, a goal easily attainable by a young man as talented as this one. On that fateful day, one of the hottest days in San Francisco history, a known crack addict, Mr. Stanley Williams, cheated this youth out of his hard-earned dollar. Now, according to the rules of the street, this young man was called upon to make an example of Mr. Williams. So he withdrew his gun in front of his friends and other street witnesses and pulled the trigger. This was no hardened criminal we're talking about. He's never been to jail, nor does he have a police record. And in what can only be seen as an act of internal compassion, turned the weapon away from its alleged victim and to the sky! After the shot was fired, there was no blood. There was no bullet hole. But Mr. Williams was dead. Why? Extreme drug abuse? Heat prostration. Pure crack panic. My client is also being tried for the death of Mr. Williams' 8-year-old son, who died in Mr. Williams' overheated car, with his windows rolled up by Mr. Williams as a result of his psychotic drug addiction. I throw myself and my client on the mercy of this court and plead with a jury for a clear vision to see that this young man was predisposed to make these decisions by society that did not include him. Ladies and gentlemen, we have an obligation to look at the bigger picture in the interest of stemming the flow of rapidly dwindling African Americans in San Francisco. We have to take a hard look once again at jail culture, as this seems to permeate our lives as a rite of passage and is viewed as a natural part of the growth process. And we do not accept this as natural course of business and or solution. If we were Firestone tires blowing out at the rate that African Americans are going to jail, 56% when compared to the population they represent, 5%, we would have been recalled. The system would have been recalled and a federal investigation would have been demanded 50 years ago. Ladies and gentlemen, we have, for these few reasons, an obligation to reinvestigate incarceration as it affects us as a society, as a whole. The big question is not what to do to stop the problem. The big question is, what do we do to stop recidivism? What mindset do we need to have to adapt to defend ourselves against a system that will not change and not only continues to wreak havoc in our communities and warp the minds of our youth?
The prison industrial complex, still a question that we have. As we march forward from the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, to our current state, we still have a question about jail. And what does it do to the family structure? Because there's always this internal knowledge that when one goes, we all go.
What do you think is wrong, Lex? I cannot believe I'm sitting here in the penitentiary during visiting hours just so I can talk to you. No, wait a minute. Let me tell you about my day. First, I had to get up at 3:30 this morning, take the girls over to Becky's place and give her some money I don't have. Then I gotta catch a bus downtown and take another bus to bring me up here. Then I have to wait in the pre-screen room to find out if they have enough space for everyone, and if they don't, I have to go home and try again later. Then I make my way up in here and some guard tries to push up on me. Do you know what it's like for a single female trying to raise kids out here on her own, pay the rent, get them to school, feed them and myself with no job, and you ask me what's wrong? Now, I realize that you may be a little stressed with some of these nuts that you're in here with, but they sure don't look any different than the fools you used to hang out with on the corner. So you should feel right at home right about now. Watching TV all day, having room service meals, sleeping all you want. Fuck you, Lex. Don't even start with that sorry shit. Every time you get busted by me, the police, or your mama, the first thing out of your mouth is, I'm sorry, baby. It wasn't my fault. Well, whose fault was it then, Lex? Huh? Who set you up this time? Where's the conspiracy to get Lex? I can't take this. Can't you see what you're doing to me?
No contact!
Lex, I miss your touch. You know how long it's been since we made love. I love you, Lex. Always have. And I'ma stand by you to the end. But I don't know if I can live like this. I don't even remember being a child, except for watching cartoons in the morning and walking to the store for penny candy. And the next thing I know, I'm 16 and got two babies by Lex. Lex, all the time you've been gone, I've been grieving like you were dead or something, even though I know you aren't. I've been stuck in this dark place the same way I was when my brother got killed. I've been thinking and reflecting, not just once, but the entire time you've been gone. I realize that I've always been searching for those men I lost in my life. When I was a little girl, I would hope to see my daddy or someone that was just like my brother. I was always searching for someone or something that I lost or maybe never really had. I was so busy searching that I never even saw myself. And when we hooked up, I never looked back. It's like we were doing what we were supposed to be doing. Now I want you to want me. And I want me to want you. Not like following some age-old plan we had no decision in making. Now, I've seen and done things that I've only read and saw on TV. We don't have to live like this, Lex. I want us to see the whole world and all it has to offer us. Well, I'm doing time just like you're doing time. What I'm saying, Lex, is I need to move on. I need to try to get up off this spot. Now, I can't wait another 3 years for the parole board just to let us leave town. I can't take it. I've got a chance, and I want you to give me your blessing to go.
Rights movement in the 1970s brought about the end of the Black Revolutionary Movement. And this end was signified by the ignominious death of the poster child for Black Revolution at that time, one Huey P. Newton. This is a man both revered and reviled, both hero and criminal, and who probably gave as much to the Black community as anyone before or since. For that we say, so long, Huey. So long.
You know, the Bible says when the blind lead the blind, they both shall fall into the ditch together. Last time I saw Huey was right here in this Westco Oakland infamous acorn housing project, right next to the Cypress Freeway that would soon come tumbling down October 17, 1989. In 1984, I became addicted to crack cocaine. For many people, especially members of my family, they found my addiction difficult to understand. "You're so strong," they would say. "How could you become a weak, pitiful dope fiend?" What did I get? My addiction came to me in my 40th year. For many people, a time of disillusionment with life. Certainly was for me. I was burned out, tired. Tired of revolution, family life, sex, women. Just burned out. Tired of working for the educational system. Tired of the Black middle class and the grassroots. Tired of religious sectarianism, both Christian and Muslim alike. Just tired. I was burned out. Maybe this is what happens when one lives too fast. You run out of ideas. But a voice came to me and said, "You shall become like Sisyphus. You shall roll a rock up to the top of the mountain, and it will fall to earth each day, and you will begin again for all eternity, since you can't think of anything else to do, you big dummy." So I was a sitting duck for addiction. Well, a new addiction. Especially when I became an entrepreneur. Oh yeah, you know me. You see me down there, marketing Powell. I was selling incense, oils, soaps, all kinds of stuff. My pocket was fat. I made a lot of fast money. Yeah, I loved it. But I didn't like making the money.
feel guilty about it.
So my friends, including my so-called Muslim brothers, introduced me to crack cocaine to help me with my problem. I ain't like sniffing cocaine. Makes your mind all speedy and peppy and everything. I mean, I'm already speedy enough. I don't need that. I like to be mellow. Smoke some weed, you know what I mean? Now I admit, I abused marijuana for over 20 years. Smoked it from morning to night. Thought for sure I was gonna die of an overdose of weed, wine, and women. But along came crack. And I soon lost all interest for weed, wine, and women. With all my knowledge, I had forgotten life's simple rules. Why not sing a happy song? Takes the same amount of energy as singing the blues. Why not sing a happy song? Why? Why couldn't I see all the beautiful things that I had been blessed with? The most beautiful parents, willing, caring. The most beautiful brothers and sisters. The most beautiful, intelligent women any man could ever want. Why? Why? I know now. It's because I knew it all. I knew everything. I had the answer to it all. I knew it all. Yeah. Yeah. You know, I didn't like the way crack made my friends act. I'd come in the house. They wouldn't even know I was there. They were all mesmerized. Understand it. How could anybody let something like this just lead them everywhere and anywhere until the pipe caught me? That's right. I lost my house behind the pipe. I lost my wife behind the pipe. I lost all my money. My children. I lost my mind behind the pipe. I lost my life. Sent me to the mental hospital four times. Four times! You know, I take one of them 747 mega blast of paramedic hits, you know what I'm talking about, burn it down, boy, yeah, and I take me a... I feel the strangest sensation coming over my body. It was real strange. It was the sensation of death. And I run through the window for air. Run outside, try to walk it off. Oh yeah, yeah, I'm down now. As soon as the sensation of death had passed me by, you know what I did? I sat right back down. Took me another hit. Once, I cut my wrist. I think it was an accident. I cut my wrist. You know, I was smoking and I dropped my pipe. And I went and I reached for it like that. And the glass cut my wrist. Cut an artery. artery bleed. It's like someone turned on a water faucet. The blood just kept coming, pouring out. I took my handkerchief and I tied it around my wrist because I thought the bleeding would stop, but it didn't. My friend tried to stop me, you know, get me to go to the hospital, but I kept on smoking. I pulled up my backup pipe, because every good dope fiend has got to have a backup pipe, you know. I pulled that out, and I fired that up, and my pipe was covered in blood. The dope was the color of blood. My clothes, all covered in blood. The floor, the curtains, the table, the rug, everything was covered in blood. The bed was all covered in blood. My friend, who tried to get me to go to the hospital and stop, ran out and got the hotel manager, who of course returned with a baseball bat and forced me out. When the paramedics came and took me to San Francisco General, they quickly moved me into the ER where the tech stitched me up. The nurse gave me some of those little bus tokens. And I got on the bus, the 9 San Bruno, some of you know, to return down to the Tenderloin, to go back to my room, to continue doing what I had been doing before I had been so rudely interrupted.
Wow.
That's right. What's up? Huh? Oh, y'all don't hear me. Many times I thought of my friend, Huey P. Newton. I'd seen him just a couple weeks earlier. Little did I know that this would be the last time I would see him alive. For he was found murdered August 22nd, 1989, right underneath the Cypress Freeway. After stealing my door! For those of you still addicted to crack cocaine and any other drug, you should feel blessed that you're still alive and have the opportunity to save your souls for the sake of yourself, your family, and your community. I have no doubt that I will fully recover. Each day I get stronger. I have no other choice but to fight or die. Because surely, America is at war with the black nation. They're using an endless supply of guns for our self-annihilation and a chemical germ warfare. But we have the greatest weapon of all, which is our spirit, which is the spirit of God. He is in us, and we are in him. When we forget this, we fall victim to the great lie that all is lost. Now I know it's raining now. But see the sun coming through the rainbow? And the clouds? I see the rainbow. Rise, my people! Rise from the alleyways! Rise from the crack houses! Rise! Reclaim your soul! A great warrior has fallen today, and with his demise, I thank him for all he gave us. Salam, Huey. Salam.
See? That's exactly what I was telling y'all about. And these are the people I was telling you about. And this is the spot where they reside. It's the sad state of affairs when as big as the world is, all you can think of is your little postage stamp sized neighborhood. Your connection to this spot won't let you move or think in another direction. Some people haven't been downtown in 5 years. Haven't crossed the other side of the bay in 20 years. How are you ever going to be free if you don't step out of the mental cage that you built for yourself, dog? You don't hear me though. You think I'm just a crazy bum talking nonsense. What I got to say, you don't want to hear. This is madness. This is a continuous cycle of misinformation. We don't even know that we are an endangered species. I may be homeless, but at least I'm free!
I want to thank everybody for being here. Now, this isn't like having to stay after school or anything, but we do like to take about 10 minutes and do a little Q&A, because as you know, we're operating on a shoestring, and your voice, your thoughts, and what you think are very, very important to us, because you know this is not a big money-making operation. But before we proceed too much further, I want to first acknowledge Ms. Gloria Weinstock, our director. And I just want to make sure that we have an opportunity to talk. Anybody got any questions? Anybody any thoughts? Should we keep this thing going? Should we pack it in? What do you think? Is it relevant? Is it not relevant? Are we too old? What? Oh, do I need to, okay, I'll start picking on somebody. So. Yeah, what's up, man? What's going on?
How do you feel?
I feel fantastic. I feel really good. I feel accomplished. I think that this is a crafted piece of performance art. Not only to our mission, but my personal conviction itself. And so I'm very happy, very happy. You know, we managed to record this thing, so we'll deal with that later, but I'm really happy about it. Yes, sir.
It's amazing. I just love the way you just ran through history and how it reflects on, like, hey, the people of the past can show you what can happen to the present. And it's just so prevalent today.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes?
I have a question and a comment. Who wrote this? Who wrote the monologues? And
well, there are several pieces. Gloria's probably going to jump in a minute. No, we took composites. There's a very, the very first that you saw was that one monologue from a soldier's play. Okay, the opening was me, I wrote that. I wrote all the opening, I wrote the lawyer, I wrote the scene, you know, there was something else there, I forgot what else. But Ben Caldwell did the preacher and the minister, and then we had that scene from August Wilson's Two Trains Running, right? But it's right there on the program.
I just felt like it was so relevant. There were certain lines that just really, I felt like I could relate to, that just really hit me. Just the way they were performed, and the writing is beautiful, and the way you performed theater. I love the idea of recovery theater. How do you define recovery? Because I know that, you know, there are certain ways that people define it. And as far as how would you define recovery, and how would recovery theater define recovery?
Well, how I redefine recovery and recovery theater are probably synonymous, since I am recovery theater. You know, and everybody else is associated. All the actors, almost everybody here has been with me for an extended period of time. We have a relationship, okay? And they were picked for a specific reason. And, you know, I don't want to get really long-winded because, you know, I can. But in a nutshell, we generally do a roll call. I could do a simple roll call, which is, you know, any crackheads in the audience? In recovery or out? Any heroin addicts? Weed heads? Dope fiends? Alcoholics? Cigarette smokers? You know, cyber nuts? You know, shoppers? Sexaholics? We are all...
Borders.
Borders. Yeah. We could go on and on and on. And I really meant it when I say recovery is really nothing but discovery. You know, recovery has got a bad rap. You know, we are all in a state of evolving and evolving to a higher state or more sensitive state of consciousness. And that's all we are doing, any opportunity. My firm belief is that a quality production taken to people who don't often get an opportunity to see a piece of work that is quality and professional is sometimes all the food that is needed to make a change. I know once I saw something, it bit me and never let go. So, as I said, I could go on and on, but I think you got the gist.
Yes.
Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I just want to say it's inspiring to see you guys perform, because it's been a long time for me since I've acted. And you guys you bit me and I fell in love again.
Come on, baby, we got you.
Bring it. Comment on that. Yes, she keep going, yes. Have you ever thought about putting the second part of it from the 90s on, and how from 1984, from that first hit of crack, from Huey P. Newton, how it led us to through our music, through all the other brainwashing systems we got, to where we're at now, with, you know, with everything going on today? Have you ever thought about that? And that might be a way to hit the younger generation and get them involved, but still teach them the history that they so often miss.
Right. Well, you know what? I'm going to defer to my director right now for that one, because you know, as any production, there's budgetary constraints.
I'm scared of that. I'm scared of that.
This piece, its relevance, I don't know how to say it, but we put this together so quickly. We grabbed from here, from there, and we threaded it. And this is why I love theater. Because I won't do this to you, but theater is it in its simplicity, when you keep it simple, it's at its strongest. And this is the simplest that we could come up with and be as effective as possible. I didn't know how this piece was going to turn out when we started. Jeffrey said, we're going to do this, we're going to back. How about doing this? Let's wrap this piece, isn't it? Okay, all right, just give me this stuff. And he started throwing this stuff at me. I said, Jeffrey, that's enough. Okay, now wait, we've got to add a few more minutes here. We got to add a few more. And we figured an hour would be enough. We got it to 54 minutes, and it's enough, and I'm very proud of that. And I have to say that, you know, some of them, I took them out of their comfort zone, and I wanted to knock up a few heads. The love, the generosity that they have what got them where they are right now. And I'm proud of you.
Oh yeah, we got a whole lot more.
But we, you know, we had to keep it simple because it was a time constraint, and we got the theater, blah, 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 blah. Last 2 weeks in July, oh, really? That's all we had? So we did, but we, you know, time, budget, hoping that this is, there is more. There, yeah, and this is condensed. Some of this, because Geoffrey's pieces are out of a whole play.
Right. Yeah. It's a two-hour piece that we would actually at some point like to present.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gloria. Hold on for 1 second. Let me start in the back. Young lady, what's your name?
I just want to say that in my almost 57 years, I've never been to a play in my life, and it was very, very good. I cannot say how. It was amazing. Aww. And I can relate to some things, you know, when you go back to my past, and it was heavy.
Well, I want to thank you, and I want to also say something to you and maybe some other people here.
And is it relevant? Yes, I absolutely believe that it should be continued.
Thank you. One of the things that, who was asking me, how does recovery theater fit? Anyway, the whole point is that you are as much a part of our production as we are as the performers. We don't necessarily draw a line between the fourth wall. You need to understand that we create a safe zone here. It's a safe zone. And it's a safe zone that people can talk, say what they need, ask questions. Some people, and I'm very, very proud that you would say, hey, look, you know, I ain't been to a play. You know, that's what we're about. You're our audience. We try to reach you. And so that's what we're about. If, you know, anybody's gonna really need to get a picture of it. That's kind of what we're about. Thomas, what do you want to say?
I just wanted to say that I really appreciate your commitment for the vision and the mission that you said you could work for. And that it's, as we say in the arts, it's deeply rooted, and that comes through to deal with some of the issues that you deal with, and also the multiple audiences that you're trying to touch and reach. And I would say the same thing for your ensemble in terms of their commitment to put deep into the material also. So,
thank you, Thomas. Thomas Simpson, Afro Solo.
Can you share with us the process of when you came up, or who came up with the idea of putting this piece together? You know, what sparked your drive to come and do this, and then go find Gloria and find these actors? Like, how did this come to life?
Well, you know, you probably had to park it for about 2 weeks for me to get into to that one, but. Simply put, we'll get to Gloria in a second. Simply put, opportunity meets preparedness meets chance. You know, it's really, really that, because, you know, aside from the commitment, aside from everything, we got the theater, as Gloria was saying. But during our rehearsal, during the construction of what are we going to do, Gloria's going to speak on it, the world seemed to turn up.
It exploded.
It just blew.
The world literally exploded. Changed.
You know? Go ahead, Gloria.
Finding these pieces, really was Geoffrey. I had a whole different thing in mind, you know? I was with another company, and he picked up my contract. And put it out there. I always say, put it out there, the universe will give it to you. And I wanted to get back to the community, and the universe put me in Geoffrey's circles. And he started bringing these pieces, and as I said, we looked at them, and he brought the actors. I knew I would work with his people. That's fine. But not knowing
what the show is going to be is, you know, I love a challenge. Yeah. it makes it exciting. It's a challenge that a lot of people wouldn't even want to even look at. Most programs are planned a year ahead. But we did this as we were going. We were putting things together. We had a theme, and we started putting it together, and the thread is what makes it work. Always the thread. Because these pieces alone, yes, they're relevant, but if you don't connect them to the thread, and that was Geoffrey's narrations, you just get a bunch of beads. You know, now we have a nice necklace. And that's, you know, when you want to do it, when you want to do what you love doing, there's always a way of doing it.
Yeah.
You always get placed there. I do.
Yeah.
And I welcome the challenge.
Oh, we welcome you. We welcome you.
And I feel blessed.
Sleeping during the first time I saw the spot, I was asleep. And I use sleeping and awake in different terms. You guys probably won't get it, or you do. I'll let you decide. But I was sleeping for a long time. It was recent. I woke up recently.
Hey,
you
woke up.
And I woke up. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, you want to present this to Miss Gloria Weinstock. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to keep you too long because I know how it is, but we appreciate each and every one of you and your time. If you see somebody, let them know what you saw. Show them about, hold on for 1 second. There's one person we forgot.
Amen.
Gloria.
Yeah.
Everybody step to the side for a second. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the essential members of this production and keeps everything going is our stage manager, Pamela. So So thank you so much. If you have any questions, feel free to ask us afterwards, but we're getting ready to go hit the party. Okay?
Also, if you'd like to see further adventures of SFRT in San Francisco, we have had a show going, cabaret show, going at Martuni's, which is on Valencia and Market Street here in San Francisco, for 5 years strong now. So we changed it. We it's a different thing every time, but we've been going strong, and we'd love to see you there sometime. It's the second Saturday of the month.
Yes.
Second Saturday of the month, 7 o'clock sharp at Martuni's. So come on down there and just have a
moment. We'll also be here again on the 12th of August from 5 to 7.
Right.
We're going to be doing our Ode to the Black Hawk Jazz Club, which is a jazz piece that we do about the Black Hawk Jazz Club. If you don't know anything about it, you better come on down and check it out.
All right?
All right. Thank you so much.